Less than 2 weeks before Christmas, it's an amazing 65 degrees in Statesboro. What a beautiful night for the 36th edition of the App State Georgia Southern rivalry here at Paulson Stadium. And good evening. I'm Matt Stewart, joined by Danny Waugh. Danny, a year ago, Eagles spoiled the Mountaineers' New Year's Day 6 bowl hopes and handed the four-time Sun Belt champs their only loss of the season.
That's right. What would have been a perfect season for the Mountaineers was spoiled by the Eagles. Georgia Southern had a 24-7 lead going into the fourth quarter, and App State tried to fight their way back, scored two touchdowns in the fourth, and even got the ball back with 1:13 in the game, but ran out of time as the Eagles would win in Boone on Halloween night.
Rivalry recap. App leads the all-time series the two have played every year since 1993.
And what a rivalry it is to go from the SoCon now to the Sun Belt, and usually this game has implications on the Sun Belt Conference Championship in the East Division, and this is the first time that this game's been played on a Saturday night since 2013.
Coaches preaching energy over emotion. There will be plenty of both here tonight. Pride and bragging rights on the line. It's Georgia Southern and App State. Opening kick is coming up next. Conference on ESPN as we welcome you back to Paulson Stadium. 7-3 App State, 7-4 Georgia Southern, playing for second place in the Sun Belt East here tonight. And already, Danny, before the game, things got a little emotional.
That's what you like to see right there. That's what this rivalry is all about. The one time out of the year these two teams face off against each other, and you know the Mountaineers have a chip on their shoulder losing to the Eagles in the last two seasons.
So the officials already busy trying to separate the two teams here tonight. And the head coach of the Mountaineers, Sean Clark, 364 days ago, he was promoted to replace Aliyah Drinkwitz, who became the head coach at Missouri. His first game, just 8 days later, led App State to a 31-17 win over UAB in the New Orleans Bowl. And he is 8-3 here at the end of his first full season as the Mountaineers head coach. And Chad Lunsford has never lost to App State as a head coach. 2-0 against the Mountaineers, 26-17 in his third full season.
He's done a tremendous job leading the Eagles against the Mountaineers. And with this game being played at the very end of the season, normally it's played in the middle of the year in October. This game is pretty much a makeup game that was initially supposed to happen in October, but now happening here in the final regular season game for both of these programs. And some would say that's where it needs to be, towards the end of the season. It's one of those big rivalry games. Some would say maybe one of the best rivalry games in the G5.
Georgia Southern will be receiving first as Riker Casey, the redshirt freshman, out of New Smyrna Beach, Florida, has teed it up for the Mountaineers, and they're ready to go. In their white, gold, and black, and Caleb Hood will take the kick 3 yards deep in the end zone. He's bringing it out. And Hood is going to be stopped at the 13-yard line. And the decision by Caleb Hood, an emotional decision perhaps, to bring it out of the end zone 3 yards deep, cost him some yardage here.
You're going to see that a lot. You're going to see a lot of emotion from players on both of these sides as this game moves along. Wouldn't be surprised if the chippiness continues throughout this game, especially in the first series of both teams.
Justin Tomlin getting his second started quarterback in place of the injured Shy Wirtz. You take a look at his numbers. He's out of Southwest DeKalb High School there in the Atlanta area. And word is Tomlin did not practice much this week. He got banged up in that victory against Florida Atlantic last week, and we might see Miller Mosley or maybe even Caleb Hood taking some snaps. Tomlin going to run option on the first play. He gets dropped at the 15-yard line. Tackle made by Nick Hampton and Caleb Sperling.
Yeah, and here's the thing. You know, he had an MRI done prior to this game, and test came back clean. No significant damage, but that knee may be nagging him a little bit, so it'll be interesting to see how much Tomlin can take as his game rolls along.
It's interesting. Doug Roos, the interim offensive coordinator, said he did not know just how tough Justin Tomlin was, but found that out in that game against Florida Atlantic. Tomlin's going to run it again up to the 20-yard line, tackled by the safety Ryan Huff. His helmet comes off, so he comes out of the ball game.
Already, well, take a look at Miller Mosley coming in to replace Tomlin. Solid run up the middle for a couple of yards. ran for 78 yards and 20 carries against Florida Atlantic last Saturday night.
So Miller Mosley, the fifth-year senior out of Mobile, Alabama, transfer from Wofford, checks in on third down and three. And the handoff, and Logan Wright not going anywhere, and the Mountaineers have stopped the Eagles in a three and out on their opening possession.
And next man up has definitely been the key phrase going out through this season. Miller Mosley has not played in any games this year, so imagine that, your first game coming in against your top rival in Appalachian State.
You saw number nine, Demetrius Taylor, the defensive end, making the tackle. He is an absolute monster at 6'1", 295. Anthony Beck on the punt, standing at his 5-yard line. And Beck booms it out of there. That is an absolute boomer. Malik Williams going back to the 26 to field it. Williams up across the 40 and the 45-yard line, runs out of bounds at the 49, and flags are out way back at the 32-yard line. So, Danny, this one likely is going to come back.
Yeah, Williams had some space up the right side. Once, like you said, a booming kick from Anthony Beck, able to send it deep downfield. And we'll see what the call is and see if App State moves back a bit.
Kyle Olson, our referee.
Return, illegal block in the back. Return team, number zero. It's a 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
So Mylon Tucker is called for the block in the back.
And there you see, he trying to keep his hands up, going through, just collided with a member of the Eagles punt team.
So instead of having the ball at their own 49-yard line, App State will instead start at their own 21. And there, their veteran quarterback, Zach Thomas, fifth-year senior, has accounted for 19 touchdowns this season, 17 passing, 2 rushing. He does have 10 interceptions this year.
Well, he's had to adapt a lot throughout this season with a couple of senior wide receivers being hurt throughout the year. And you can't forget Corey Sutton opting out to play here in the 2020 season as well.
Play action, Thomas going for the home run over on the far sideline, and it's broken up at the 40-yard line by Daryl Baker, trying to get it to Christian Wells.
And Thomas is going to want to have a great game here in Statesboro. You got to remember, last time he was here in Statesboro, Georgia, he was out after the first series and did not play the rest of that game.
It looked like Christian Wells actually became the defender on that play, knocking the ball away from Daryl Baker, who was set to intercept it.
Yeah, able to prevent an interception there for sure.
Second down and 10. Handoff goes to Cameron Peoples. He gets jammed up right at the line of scrimmage. No running room for Peoples. Randy Wade making his 38th career start here tonight in on that tackle.
He's had a great season so far. 27 tackles on the year, that one being his 28th. Able to stop the run right up the middle. Able to break through and get past Mike Evans for the tackle.
Brings up third down and 9. Mountaineers second in the Sun Belt Conference, averaging 441 yards per game. Thomas averaging 214 yards total offense per game, 187 in the air. It's third and 9. Comes near side. That's complete at the 33-yard line, and that's going to be a first down catch by Thomas Hennigan, their top receiver.
Hennigan with his 38th reception on the season, has over 500 yards and 2 touchdowns. Expect him to be a go-to guy for Thomas. And Thomas with a lot of time and space in the pocket to let it fly.
Tackle made by Derek Canteen. Hennigan has been a go-to guy for Zach Thomas now for a number of years. Senior out of Greensboro, North Carolina. It's first and 10 now for the Mountaineers. Thomas throws it over the head of Jalen Virgil out there. Coverage was coming from Baker, so that was the wise move.
And you got, that's one thing that you mentioned, you know, Hennigan being one of the seniors on the offense for App State. Both sides have a lot of seniors that have been out throughout this rivalry for years now, and seeing all of them play in your senior years is pretty special.
A lot of seniors, a lot of those players that were recruited by Eagles defensive coordinator Scott Sloan, who was on the App staff from 2010 to 2017. Second down and 10. Zach Thomas going to run it for the first time tonight. He's going to be stopped. Justin Ellis, the defensive end, drops him for a loss.
That'll give Ellis his seventh tackle for loss this season. And you mentioned Scott Sloan being the former defensive coordinator for App State. So he knows what to expect from this offense and has prepared the Eagles a lot for this game.
Yeah, Coach Lunsford said it's helped the Eagles on both sides of the ball, having Sloan's insight on kind of the App State strategy and game plan. Third and 14 now. Blitz coming off the edge from Josue and thrown out of bounds. Was looking for Malik Williams, and now it's fourth down, punting situation for the Mountaineers.
We saw that trips right formation from App State there on third and long. And Williams going straight, coming by the curl route and then breaking outside. Would have had space to make a catch if Thomas would have connected to him.
Xavier Subic on the Melbourne, Australia. Left-footed boomer down inside the 25-yard line, and Caleb Hood dancing and dropped right there at the 25. And that's where the Eagles will be on offense for the second time tonight, scoreless in Statesboro. Eagles' victory in Boone last Halloween 2019 was devastating to the Mountaineers' season.
Yeah, you see the contrast in styles there with the Eagles over 300 yards on the ground. Zach Thomas was able to get things going in the fourth quarter of that game, 271 passing yards. But both teams missing a key piece in both of their offenses for Georgia Southern. Wesley Kennedy had 145 yards in that matchup, and Corey Sutton had the two touchdowns in the fourth quarter for the Mountaineers.
Tomlin running option. Hood the pitch man and tosses to Hood, and he's out of bounds, shy of the 30-yard line. Picks up a couple of yards on the play. But it was devastating to the App State season because they had just been ranked and they were in the national conversation for perhaps landing a New Year's Day 6 bowl game, and that wiped it out.
It's actually happened both times. The last two times the Eagles have faced the Mountaineers, they were ranked for the first time of the season. And then their first game as being ranked, they ran into Georgia Southern, and the Eagles were able to get the win.
So many huge games between these two teams over the years. SoCon and then Sun Belt. And there's the run by Logan Wright up to the 33-yard line. He picks up five on the play. Boy, what the last couple of games Logan Wright has had since the loss of J.D. King to the season-ending knee injury and then Wesley Kennedy to suspension.
Yeah, Logan Wright had a great game last week against Florida Atlantic. He ran for 57 yards, had the one offensive touchdown on the night, and then made two big 30-yard catches from Justin Tomlin downfield, made up for 65 of Justin Tomlin's 70 passing yards.
Third down and two. Running option again, and Tomlin not going to get there. Going to be thrown for a loss by Trey Cobb, who played his high school ball not far from here. He was a Ware County Gator in high school. He makes the TFL right there.
You know, Doug Roos talked about how tough Justin Tomlin is, but some of the mistakes that he makes is trying to make a decision whether to pitch that ball or not the last possible second. You see there, thought about letting it go, had nowhere to go. And got taken down for a loss.
So Anthony Beck punting for the second time. 54 yards on his first kick in this game. And Malik Williams standing deep for the Mountaineers at 27. Another rainbow shot that Malik Williams has to go back to the 16 to get and bobbled it as he caught it. And that's where the Mountaineers will start their second possession. They have not had good field position yet. The weather here tonight in Statesboro is absolutely fabulous. 62 degrees less than 2 weeks before Christmas Day.
Yeah, that's something you don't really see. It was cold here in Statesboro in the last week or so. It was even cold in their game against Florida Atlantic, but things have warmed up quite a bit here tonight against App State. It makes a December game feel like an early October game for sure.
This is the latest these two teams have ever played against each other. The previous was December 8th in the FCS quarterfinals. Handoff goes to Peoples, and Cameron Peoples up to the 23-yard line. A pickup of 5 on the play for Peoples. 738 yards rushing on the season for Peoples and 7 touchdowns.
It's going to be a busy night for Peoples and for Nate Noel, the freshman running back, because we found out prior to the game today that Marcus Williams isn't going to play. Didn't even make the trip down to Statesboro for this matchup.
And, of course, they're also without Daytrick Harrington, who's been out since a couple of weeks ago with an injury. This time of the season, everybody is beat up. Peoples gets it again, runs to the sticks, and picks up the first down.
And that was one thing defensive coordinator Scott Sloan talked about, how, you know, the season has taken a toll. Each week is more and more. When you're playing a 12-game season within 15 weeks, and you have to remember games that were postponed early in August and September, it definitely takes a toll. It changes how you practice leading up in the week as well.
There's no doubt about it. This has been a longer than 12-game season because of what you just said right there. How many times have the Eagles been practicing for a game that whole week and then there not be a game?
Right.
Same thing for App State and so many other teams around the country this year. Peoples, his third consecutive run, and nothing this time as he is tackled by Reed Dedman and Raymond Johnson.
The defensive line so far has done such a tremendous job making the stops on runs. First, it was Justin Ellis. Now, Raymond Johnson from behind. Vic Cabral deserves a lot of credit for the way he's coached his D-line up through this season, because they've been able to come through game in and game out.
And Georgia Southern coming off a defensive performance in which they did not allow a touchdown last week against Florida Atlantic. Second down and 11, Thomas to the air and throwing underneath at the 31-yard line, and it's broken up. Hennigan the target and Canteen on the coverage.
And Derek Canteen just had a tremendous year for himself. The redshirt freshman picked up his 5th interception last week against Florida Atlantic. Although if you look back, Chad Lunsford said he wished that Canteen would have batted the ball out of the air rather than make an interception at the 3-yard line. Would have gave the Eagles some good field position on offense.
Third down and 11. Heavy rush coming up the middle. Zach Thomas going to try to run through it, and he does. Up to the 40-yard line and slides for the first down. What a heady play by the veteran quarterback, who is 30-5 as an all-time starter.
Yeah, making it another start, and just look at the pressure by Georgia Southern defense. Was able to break one tackle, changes direction from north-south to east-west to create some space, and able to get the first down, absorbs the hit. Slides for the first.
And once he gets the first down, has the wisdom to get down. First and 10 now. Big pickup on third down by Zach Thomas. Sun Belt preseason offensive player of the year. Hasn't quite worked out that way for him this year. Pass across the middle. It's caught right in traffic, and Malik Williams down to the 41-yard line.
Sean Clark said how proud he was of Zach, because things kind of haven't gone his way throughout the year, but he's been able to adjust. He's had some bad games, but also he had some games where he wasn't playing with the weapons that he's normally equipped with.
38 catches now for Malik Williams this season as he goes over 500 yards in the year, averaging 55 yards per game catching the ball. That's Pearson, the tight end, in motion. Hand off Peoples. They meet him in the backfield. Great penetration there by Rashad Byrd, making his 25th consecutive start here, the big senior linebacker.
And nobody had Rashad Byrd there on that play. Had the basic 3-4 and then had the middle linebacker blitz. And Byrd was right there to make the stop.
Second down and 10, ball at the 42. Nearly 10 minutes into this first quarter, scoreless App State, Georgia Southern. Quinn Williams creeping up on the edge. Here he comes off the blitz. He's got a shot at him. Quarterback sack for Quinn Williams. You saw that coming from a mile away, and Zach Thomas still couldn't get away.
Yeah, you saw the outside linebackers were showing blitz before the snap. And what a job by Williams, able to break off on the outside. He's able to get past Cameron Peoples, who was supposed to make the block on the outside linebacker, and Thomas had no time at all. You see the emotion about what this rivalry means to both teams.
Third and 23 now after the sack by Quinn Williams. Quick throw out to Malik Williams, trying to set up a screen. He will not get anywhere close to the first down as Anthony Wilson, the safety, drives him out of bounds. It's fourth down, another punting situation for App State.
So this drive, the Mountaineers were able to make some progress going with the screen on third down. Got a couple of yards, but 2 yards shy.
What they were able to do, Danny, is guarantee that they can flip the field again because they were pinned deep in their 16. They moved the ball out far enough for Subic to try to pin the Eagles deep again. Caleb Hood, and this is a spiraling kick. It's going to be taken at the 14-yard line, and once again, Eagles saddled with poor field position with just under 4 minutes to play here in the first quarter. State defense has held Georgia Southern to just 6 plays and 15 total yards so far in this game.
Yeah, it's been hard for the Eagles to get things going on the running game. And as we talked about before, Justin Tomlin not 100% trying to tough it out and seeing what he can do. But on some of those reads on the outside, the defense from App State was there to make the stop.
So first and 10 for the Eagles from their own 15-yard line. Gerald Green gets his first carry of the ball game, gets maybe a yard on the play. And we were talking about how Georgia Southern spoiled App State's New Year's Day 6 bowl hopes last year. Could be happening tonight with Troy now leading Coastal Carolina with just 1 minute and 20 seconds left in that game.
Yeah, it's been a magical season for the Chanticleers, but now in some trouble, was ranked as high as 13th in the college football playoffs, still hoping for a potential New Year's Six bowl, but it's not looking good for him right now.
So we'll keep you updated on that as Troy has just scored with less than 2 minutes to go to take the lead in that game. Tomlin running option here. And Tomlin slips a tackle up across the 30. He might go. It's a foot race. Tomlin finally caught at the 30-yard line by Huff.
What a big run there. You see Workers around the outside. Decides to keep it, breaks the tackle. Good blocking outside from Darian Anderson. Like you said, a foot race. Luckily, from out near is Ryan Huff, who's able to trip up Tomlin, preventing a touchdown.
How about Justin Tomlin subbing for the injured Shy Wirtz, who came out to take the coin toss for the Eagles tonight in what might just be his final game as an Eagle here at Paulson Stadium, and he's not getting a chance to play it. 55-yard run by Tomlin. Gives the Eagles the ball at the 29. Now Tomlin across the middle, intercepted at the 15-yard line, and the Mountaineers get it right back. Picked off by Brendan Harrington, the outside linebacker. And after the big run by Tomlin, he turns it over.
The Eagles went 2 steps forward, but then going 3 steps back. You see Tomlin was looking for Malik Murray in the middle, but didn't throw it high enough to get past Brendan Harrington, who notches his 4th interception on the year.
So the Mountaineers get the first big turnover of the ball game, and it thwarts what was the first great scoring opportunity for the Eagles tonight. Zach Thomas brings the offense back out with 2:39 to play in the quarter. Ball at the 15-yard line. Only 43 yards of offense so far for the Mountaineers, and Nate Noel getting his first carry of the ball game picks up a couple of yards.
You know, it's just you talked about how Shy Wirtz, the senior, wasn't going to be able to play here today. It's just something that a lot of fans wish they could see, just having the two senior quarterbacks in Zach Thomas and Shy Wirtz, who have been premier quarterbacks in the Sun Belt throughout their careers.
So second down and 7, there is no doubt about it. Thomas throwing on the run and intercepted at the 29. Spaulding, touchdown, pick 6, Georgia Southern. Touchdown,
the cannon fires, the youth of the secondary for Georgia Southern has really stepped up throughout this season. Derek Cantina, redshirt freshman. How about David Spaulding, the redshirt freshman from Riceboro? Able to read that pass, get an interception, and able to get the Eagles on the board.
Rayner on for the PAT. Beck, the punter, is the holder. Langen, the snapper. 7-0, Georgia Southern. How about that? The two teams swap INTs. This one a pick six for David Spaulding, the backup corner who jumped the route, anticipated the pass attempt to Hennigan, and had smooth sailing into the end zone.
Able to read it very well. Hennigan just unable to get in front. Just a tremendous read from Spaulding. His first interception, and a big one at that. Taking it back for six.
Meantime, at Troy, Grayson McCall, a 23-yard touchdown pass with 35 seconds to go, and the Chanticleers back on top, 42-38.
Man, Coastal Carolina has had some exciting games. You point back to the game last week, taking on BYU on day's notice in Conway. A battle between two unbeatens who've had great season. I mean, the story of Coastal Carolina has been just so incredible to watch, where it's picked to finish at the very bottom of the East Division and have proved all the doubters wrong here through 2020. Beating Georgia Southern and App as well.
Yep. Dylan Lewis kicking off for the Eagles. And it will go out of bounds or go through the end zone. That's going to be a touchback. It went into the end zone just barely. That was close to being a penalty, but instead it goes through the end zone, and so the ball comes out to the 25-yard line. There's no doubt, App State, 7-3. This is the first time since 2015 they're not going to win at least a share of the Sun Belt Championship. Four-time Sun Belt champions. They were a combined, their teams that they lost to, the three ranked teams, a combined 26-2 on the season.
Right, and Sean Clark, the head coach, told the team the message is, how are you going to finish the season? Yeah, this is going to be the first time that they don't compete for the Sun Belt Conference Championship, but you're still competing for a bowl game as well.
And Noel, as Wilson comes up from the safety position to trip him up.
You know, offensive coordinator Tony Peterson talked about having three running backs just wasn't enough. Somewhat wishing that they had the running back depth that Georgia Southern has had throughout the season. And pretty much now, without Marcus Williams, you're down to two primary running backs throughout this game. So we'll see how many touches that Noel and Peoples will have as the night rolls on.
Noel finds a lane and cuts back up and in. Picks up just a couple of yards on the play. Not a lot of running room. Jalen Jackson, the dog backer, making the tackle. And now it's going to be third down.
With it being third and six, you would expect Zach Thomas to throw a short pass. Confidence has to be shaken a little bit after throwing an interception his last throw.
Interesting enough to follow up on your point right there. Georgia Southern and App tied with Army, the only teams in the country with five players have rushed for 100 yards this season. And neither one of the teams has those five. Hit from behind by Raymond Johnson. The ball is out, and let's see who got on top of it. Raymond Johnson snuck up from behind, and Zach Thomas did not hear him coming. And it looks like the Mountaineers avoid disaster as Ryan Newsel, the left guard, is able to get on top of it.
Raymond on the field is a fumble.
Well, you see here Raymond Johnson, just like a thief in the night, coming through as soon as Thomas was going to make the throw, swats it out of his hand. Just what a senior season for Raymond Johnson. You know, we've talked multiple times, if Raymond Johnson would end up declaring for the NFL draft, he still has an extra year of eligibility. And could you just imagine how much more he could be?
There's no doubt about it. Fair catch is called for by Hood. He dropped it, and then it's scooped up by Georgia Southern going out of bounds, and so the ball getting slippery. We've had fumbles, we've had interceptions, and the first quarter comes to a close. Let's hold on here. We have a flag. Okay, that will be the end of the first quarter. No flag on the field. The pick six by David Spaulding, our only score so far as we head to the second. Start of the second quarter here in Statesboro. Georgia Southern on top of App State, 7-0. Matt Stewart along with Danny Waugh. And Coastal Carolina comes back to beat Troy. And so the Chanticleers finish up as the East Division champions at 8-0, 11-0 overall. And they'll host Louisiana in the Sun Belt Championship game next Saturday. Green on the first carry of the second quarter for the Eagles.
What an exciting game, Troy. There were four touchdowns scored in the final 5 minutes of play. And Grayson McCall able to get a 23-yard touchdown pass with 35 seconds remaining to win and remain undefeated in the regular season. And their hopes are still up for a New Year's Six Bowl. It already depends on what happens with Cincinnati, because right now they will be the favorites. But just what a season it's been for the Chanticleers, and they've already beaten Louisiana once. See if they can make it twice.
Raging Cajuns and Chanticleers at noon Eastern next Saturday, the Sun Belt Championship on ESPN. Tomlin to the air, and it's completed the 46-yard line. Najee Thomas making the catch. Najee Thompson with the catch for the Eagles, and that'll be a first down for Georgia Southern.
Good route from Thompson. Picks up his third catch on the year. Tomlin stepping into the throw. Just got it over as Harrington was looking for a second interception.
Good confidence maker on that throw right there by Tomlin after his previous pass was intercepted. Hand off, Logan Wright pulls his way up to the 48-yard line. Ryan Huff out of Atlanta, out of Athens, making that tackle for the Mountaineers. Practically their entire secondary is from the state of Georgia. Huff is from Athens. You got Caden Smith from Lawrenceville. Jolly is from Stone Mountain. Only Gene Charles, the fifth-year senior, and Bednarik and Thorpe Award semifinalists is from the state of Florida, but all the rest of the starters back there for App from the state of Georgia.
Including the backups as well. Tommy Wright from Lithonia.
Big hit right there from DeMarco Jackson.
That's a big thing you got to think about. You know, even though these two teams are states apart, Georgia and players from both sides are recruited from both programs.
Well, App State has made a killing recruiting players out of the state of Georgia for years now. DeMarco Jackson, their leading tackler, is fifth tackle for loss this season. Now it's going to be third down and long for the Eagles. Georgia Southern has yet to convert on third down tonight. Tomlin in the pocket, throws it out here, and it's complete to Cam Brown, the tight end, and he is going to be a little bit shy of the first down, depending upon where they spot it. I think they're going to spot it short, and so do you go for it here, Danny, on fourth and one?
You have to at this point. I mean, you're able to get across the 50, so it wouldn't be the worst thing in the world if you did decide to go for it. And if I'm Georgia Southern, I put Logan Wright in the backfield and hand it off to him right at the middle. He's been a power back for the Eagles to convert first downs.
Fourth and one. Handoff, Logan Wright got it. He needed one and got two. Even though Trey Cobb, the young man out of Waycross, Georgia, came up from his linebacker spot to meet him, wasn't strong enough to push him back.
And that's what you do right there. Logan Wright, able to absorb contact and able to give you an extra yard.
So first and 10 Eagles after they convert on fourth down. First and 10 from the 43. Georgia Southern with a 10-game home winning streak. It's their longest since 2015. Leading 7-0 here early second quarter. Matt LaRoche on the carry. And Brendan Harrington, who already has an interception in this ball game, makes the tackle.
And outside of the big 55-yard run from Tomlin, you know, all these other runs from Georgia Southern on offense have been for about 2 or 3 yards. So Tomlin may have to rely on the pass a little bit if they want to move the ball downfield.
That run by Tomlin, by the way, gave the Eagles 9 runs of 40-plus yards this season. They are number 3 in the nation in that category. They lead the nation in runs 20-plus yards, 27 of those. And Gerald Green right up the middle to the 31-yard line, picks up the first down.
And the Eagles have two young and exciting running backs in Gerald Green and Jalen Wright. There you see Green is able to take the hit and move upfield, hanging onto the ball, almost had it stripped away.
Green, the budding star out of East Coweta High School, redshirt freshman. Had the big 69-yard touchdown run in the Eagles' victory over Troy last month. First and 10, going to get the rock again. This time, very little running room. Runs right into the teeth of that App State defense led by the massive 300-pound nose tackle, Jordan Earl.
Earl, only a sophomore, playing around two seniors in Demetrius Taylor and Caleb Sperling on the defensive line. He's got a great career. He's making great progress here for the Mountaineers.
Second down and 8, 5 minutes into the second quarter. Georgia Southern putting together their best drive of the ball game so far. Play action. Tomlin going over the top for the score, and Carter can't run underneath it. Tight coverage right there from Stephen Jones. Carter wanted a flag and didn't get it.
Well, on that throw, it seemed like Tomlin may have overshot Dexter Carter on the pass. You see again, was right where he wanted it. Carter just a tad shy, but
now the contact came right as the ball was getting there. Dexter Carter still looking for that flag, not going to ever get it.
It's close.
It was third down and 8. Tomlin, 2 of 4 passing, 23 yards coming into this quarter. Heavy rush. Oh, my goodness. Tomlin took a shot right under his face mask and a flag out on Demetrius Taylor. Hopefully Tomlin's okay. He appears to be, but Demetrius Taylor laid him out but got a little bit too rambunctious with his hit.
Well, you saw the two offensive guards pulling towards the left, and that was just, you saw Demetrius Taylor's eyes.
Personal foul. Roughing the passer. Defense, number 9. Half to the goal. Automatic first down.
Any defensive end would be excited to see this an open opportunity for a sack. And
they can't hit him up high like that.
Yeah, you're right.
I mean, he came in, if he makes the hit, in the torso, he's okay. But he came up high and hit him above the shoulder pads, or right there on the shoulder pads, maybe got part of the helmet as well. So a big 15-yard mark off, and that gives the Eagles the first down at the 15-yard line.
I think he got just too excited, knowing the emotions that these players have in this rivalry, but at the same time, you have to play smart.
Remember, the coach is all I'm saying, energy over emotion here. You can't let the emotions get the best of you in a game like this. Tomlin running option here, going to keep it inside the 10, inside the 5, touchdown, Tomlin and Georgia Southern, 13-0 Eagles.
Toughness of Tomlin. He's limping, making his way over to the side. We talked about how his knee wasn't 100% entering this game. This resiliency that Tomlin has staying in. It's a great run, great read. Able to get through, and at the very end, DeMarco Jackson was on the tackle. And while it is touchdown Southern, you know, you wonder if Tomlin will come back or how he's feeling at this moment.
Rayner puts it through. 15-yard touchdown run by Justin Tomlin gives the Eagles a 2-touchdown lead, but is Tomlin okay? We'll find out. Miller Mosley was warming up during the timeout as Justin Tomlin went to the medical tent after scoring on that 15-yard touchdown run.
Yeah, you saw there at the very end Tomlin limping after scoring the touchdown, and there's some time to make that decision on whether Tomlin makes his way back out or does Miller Moseley step in.
Dylan Lewis with the kickoff, and it's going to go out of bounds. So the Mountaineers will get the ball at the 35-yard line. And that's one of the things we talked about with Chad Lunsford this week. Of course, obviously, he was the special teams coordinator before becoming the head coach. So that's always been one of his specialties. And the one thing that he would really like to have is a kicker that could boom it into the end zone, but Lewis cannot do that consistently. So they find themselves trying to kick to the left corner most of the time.
Yeah, and they've been trying to work on it, and Lewis, a freshman from Sharpsburg, so he'll have plenty of time to develop that as his career moves on.
So Mountaineers down two scores now as they go back on offense. Georgia Southern trying to win three in a row in the series for the first time in close to 20 years. Blitz coming off the edge, and Detman gets to him, a quarterback sack. Reed Detman with the QBS.
And with Zion McGee out for Georgia Southern, you've seen Benz Hosway and Reed Detman really step up in the last couple of weeks. And you see Detman, he kind of got pushed right into Thomas to get that sack. That's his first sack on the year. Had a fumble recovery last week against Florida Atlantic.
Second sack of the night. Make that the third sack of the night for the Eagles. Johnson and Williams also have a pair between them. And Scott Sloan really dialing up the pressure tonight. Pass complete to Hennigan at the 35-yard line, the original line of scrimmage, and it's going to be third down and long after Spalding makes the tackle.
Well, Scott Sloan talked about how dialed in they were against Florida Atlantic, and you just think about what they were able to do. A couple of forced fumbles, a few interceptions along the way. And you're having it continue into tonight.
What's interesting is Canteen has not been out there for a while. Spalding, I don't know whether Canteen got hurt or not earlier in the game, because it was Spalding who had the pick six. Again, heavy pressure coming. It's complete to Hennigan. Spalding making the tackle. That's going to be a first down for the Mountaineers.
Well, I'm taking a look at Derek Canteen somewhat waiting by the medical tent. So there could be something up with him. We'll see what goes on there. But Spalding's done a great job coming in. He had to pick six in the first quarter.
Back to live action, the run by Peoples up to the 50-yard line. Picks up four on the play. Probably more like three. They spotted it at the 49, so second down and seven. Naked bootleg throw complete to Williams. Williams dropped at the 42-yard line. That'll be a first down. Justin Birdsong, who had such a big game last week against Florida Atlantic, starting again in place of the injured Kendrick Duncan, made that tackle. App going tempo here. And Peoples gets about three or four on the play. Detman again making the tackle.
Trying to catch Georgia Southern off their game, speeding up the tempo a little bit on offense. They've been able to make some progress in the passing game. The last three passes complete by Zach Thomas. Now trying to switch it up, opening up the offense a little bit with the run.
Interesting that Deadman's getting a lot of play here tonight as well, after Benz Hosway was their defensive player of the week last week against Florida Atlantic. Peoples runs. Flag is dropped at the 37. Let's check the call.
We're likely to be going back here.
Offense, number 60. 10-yard penalty from the previous
Noah Hannon, second down. The center, called for the holding call. And the Mountaineers playing without their fifth-year senior goal, Cole Garrison, at left tackle tonight. He's been replaced by Anderson Hardy, number 74, at left tackle.
On both sides. And Hannon, as a senior, has to be cautious of that. Can't do that when you're making progress on offense.
Thomas to the air, throws to Hennigan, and Spalding gets him on the ground right away at the 42-yard line. Spalding is really making the most of his playing opportunity here tonight. Well, they're going right at him. They know that Canteen's out of the ball game. They keep going that way.
Yeah, senior on freshman. You know, Hannigan wants to redeem himself after, you know, giving up, unable to make that catch, resulting in an interception from Spalding. Read that previous pass play very well.
App is 3 of 6 on their third downs tonight. This is a long 3rd and 11. Hennigan again, and Hennigan's going to get the first down. How about the wily veteran to curl around, find the spot in the defense, and then has the knowledge to know where the sticks are, can pick up the first down.
Yeah, great job. Was going with a slant route inside, made the catch, and instead of continuing his momentum going up towards the middle, takes a stutter step, bounces on the outside, and able to get the first down.
That guy's played a lot of big games for Appalachian State. Look at that. He even put the ball out there like he was going to pitch it, and there was nobody there. Just a fake. A fake to nobody, but maybe if the defense bites, it gets you that extra yard, and it did. First and 10 at the 31-yard line. Standard rush. They go up top. Oh, and he missed his man. Malik Williams was wide open.
That's a heartbreaker. Williams was open up the middle, was able to break past a defender, and you know, Thomas had a good throw. We'll see here again. And he had one hand. Just tried to make a one-handed catch.
It's kind of been that year for Zach Thomas, just not quite where he had been. Peoples, flag out, likely a hold coming up here against App State. As Peoples get stopped after a one-yard gain, maybe two. Again, a hold.
That's the second one here on this drive that really hurt your progression because, you know, Hennigan was able to save you the first time, but you can't make the same mistake twice.
No, you've had 20 yards in penalties and a dropped touchdown pass.
They'll be happy to try to make it out with a field goal here on this possession.
Up, number 61. Second down.
That'll back them up to the 40-yard line. Eagles, as we mentioned, going for their third straight win in the series. They have not done that since 2000 to 2002 when they beat them four times. Beat App four times in that span. That included the victory in the FCS quarterfinals. Maybe the highest stakes game that these two teams have ever played. That was Hannon again, the center called for the hold. They pick up the blitz, wide open, the tight end, and Pearson picks up the first down. Nicely done. That time they saw the blitz coming. Bird, the Mike linebacker, coming on a blitz. And Zach Thomas saw it as they go up tempo here. Peoples to the outside. And Peoples gets 9 on the play, down inside the 10 to the 9.
Well, now normally, you get second and long. Sometimes you try to go for a run to set up third down for a pass, but Thomas, once again after another holding penalty, has found the man up the middle and opening up the run game for Peoples on the outside. Great blocking. The player down for Georgia Southern, that's Rashad Byrd.
Yeah, the veteran, they're looking at his leg. Big challenge for Chad Lunsford is just to find enough healthy bodies to play. Both inside linebackers now, second or third teamers, as Rashad Byrd comes off the field. John Ferguson checks into his spot, and of course Todd Bradley's already starting after Raynard Ellis opted out a couple of weeks ago. Second and 1, Thomas gonna run it, and he picks up the first down at the 7.
Well, that's the one thing we've talked about with this being a long season and how banged up these guys are. Thomas, with this being second and 1, just needed to cross and get a first.
Josue in on that tackle, so first and goal. Oh, he did not get the first down. They spotted him short. I thought for sure he got to the 7-yard line. They spotted the ball at the 9.
A We'll see what they decide to do here. You can go for a short run. Lined up tight here.
I thought for sure he got to the 7. Third down and 1. Spin and throw, and now it's going to be 4th down and 1. How about that?
Pass is incomplete.
A little bit confused there on who he's trying to find. But being 4th down, they're going to go for it. They're staying out there. App State 9 of 17 in 4th down conversions this year.
Yeah, you don't want to get into a game like this where you're swapping field goals and touchdowns. You're down 2 already, 2 touchdowns already. You really need the first down here. And they get it as Peoples cracks in there at the 7-yard line.
Honestly, that should have been the play they chose to run on 3rd down. But nonetheless, a 1st down, right decision to go for it. This being a rivalry game, you're right. You can't trade field goals for touchdowns.
So now it really is 1st and goal to go for the Mountaineers.
Also, can we mention that it's under 3 minutes to play in the 2nd quarter? This has been a long drive from the Mountaineers.
Yeah, the drive started 9:22 mark, so it's approaching 7 minutes long. They pitch to Virgil. Virgil not going to get around the corner. Birdsong comes up with a big tackle for loss.
Birdsong, a junior out of Lithonia. He has improved so much, stepping up in the place of Kendrick Duncan.
Out of Stevenson High School there in the Atlanta area. Had a career-high 6 tackles last week and a pick against Florida Atlanta. Actually had 2 picks, one that was called back because of pass interference on Anthony Wilson. So 2nd down and goal, now back at the 11. Thomas running a fade and tightly covered Malik Wilson. Wilson, Malik Williams covered by Wilson, and now it's going to be 3rd down and goal.
So a high pass from Tomlin, just great coverage from Wilson, and there's Justin Tomlin.
And we got word that Tomlin is done for the game. They're taking him by the golf cart out of the stadium to the locker room. So it looks like Miller Mosley will be the quarterback from here on out for Georgia Southern. Meantime, it's 3rd down and goal for the Mountaineers from the 11. Exactly 2 to play in the half, and the play gets blown dead, and now it's going to be 3rd and goal from the 16.
False start. Offense. Number 11. Our penalty. 3rd down.
That's now 68 yards in penalties for App State and 0 for Georgia Southern in this game.
That's the 3rd penalty on this drive. 2 holding calls, now a false start. Just does not help with their production on offense moving downfield.
25 yards in penalties, a drop touchdown in the end zone, or a bad pass, whichever you choose to go with right there. 3rd down and goal now from the 16. Going for the end zone jump ball, and it's caught for the touchdown. Touchdown, Appalachian State. Jalen Virgil going up over the defender for the Mountaineers for score of the night.
Virgil with his 3rd touchdown reception on the year. One-on-one coverage on Darrell Baker, was able to leap over. Great catch, and that's one thing that Zach Thomas was missing in some games throughout the season, his veteran wide receiver. Sometimes it was a one-man show for Thomas with freshman wideouts, but Virgil this time able to come in clutch, and what was a lengthy drive for the Mountaineers. Able to overcome and get a touchdown after 3 penalties and a missed touchdown pass. It seemed like they worked so hard to get that touchdown. And now we'll get to see what Miller Mosley can do with under 2 minutes to play in the first half here on ESPN3.
Jalen Virgil with the touchdown catch from Zach Thomas, capping a 17-play, 65-yard drive that took 7 minutes and 27 seconds, ate up half of the 2nd quarter.
And not to mention, had to overcome 25 yards of penalties as well just to get the touchdown, but much needed for the Mountaineers.
And that ball went out at the one-yard line, and so that means the Eagles get the ball at the 35.
Out of bounds, kicking team. The ball we placed at the 35-yard line, first down.
So ball at the 35 with a minute 55 to play here in the first half. The Eagles do have all three timeouts remaining, and Miller Moseley, it's his game from here on out.
Yeah, this would be a big moment for Moseley. As we talked about, a transfer from Wofford. Played in 12 games for the Terriers last year.
Of course, Wofford did not have a season this fall. FCS not playing until the spring. So first and 10. And Moseley, the keeper, going to get dropped right away. Tim Frizzell, the outside linebacker, making the stop for the Mountaineers. So Georgia Southern is down to their third team quarterback.
Appalachian State, their first of the half.
And Appalachian State wants to get the ball back. They use the timeout, stops the clock with 1:44 to play, and will step aside as they do. Justin Tomlin, 99 yards of offense here tonight, including the Eagles' lone offensive touchdown before having to leave with an injury.
And with that, Miller Moseley has stepped in, and App State using their timeouts, knowing that they may have an opportunity to force a three and out, get the ball back, and try to tie this game up before the half is over.
Tomlin injured himself on that 15-yard touchdown run, and he has now gone to the locker room on the golf cart. So the keeper up to the 34-yard line, and the Eagles having trouble.
State, second of the half.
Moving the ball right now, and App quickly burns another timeout, and not a whole lot of time has ticked off the clock here on this sequence.
And, you know, while we're seeing Miller Moseley right now, there is a chance that we could also see the freshman Sam Kinnerson, who played a couple of weeks ago, showed up for a snap or two against Georgia State, and you were on the call for that game, Matt. You saw the quickness of Kinnerson and how he kind of worked well with the offense.
And we've also been told that we might see Caleb Hood as the quarterback here tonight as well. He would be the backup, or at least that's what we were told. He would be the backup if Moseley wasn't able to go or was ineffective.
Well, there will be a lot of discussions on what the Eagles need to do in the second half.
So third down and 11 now. Hood goes in motion. And running the pitch. And Moseley gets stopped in his tracks by Caden Smith, the strong safety. App burns another timeout very quickly.
Timeout.
And the Eagles in a punting situation. The Mountaineers are going to get the ball back with a chance to try to get a tie here before halftime.
Moseley doing what he could. Was able to move the ball upfield a little bit, but unable to get the first down. Great tackle by Caden Smith, the senior.
Only 10 seconds elapsed on those three plays. What a great job of time management by App State, using their timeouts on defense to get the ball back with lots of time left on the clock to try to get another score.
And what's big is the Mountaineers aren't going to have enough time for another 17-play drive. You may see them try to go for the home run play a couple of times when they get the ball back.
Or they might go for a punt block here or try to set up a big return. Malik Williams is standing deep for the Mountaineers at the 19-yard line, and Beck is on to punt again. Beck averaging 52 yards on his two punts so far, and another boomer off his foot. Williams calls fair catch, makes it at the 15-yard line, and so the Mountaineers will start at their 15, no timeouts remaining, and 92 seconds left in the half.
Right, either way, the Mountaineers see a moment where they can change the momentum in this game. What was pretty stalemate back and forth in the first couple of series. Georgia Southern broke that with a pick six, and then they got things going on offense with a touchdown run by Tomlin, but they had the Mountaineers had a 17-play drive, excuse me. Now a chance here of a minute 32 to try and tie it up.
Probably have to go about 60 yards to get in reasonable field goal range here. Thomas, ball batted down at the line of scrimmage. Justin Ellis got his hands on it.
Looking at some of the routes that the receivers are running for the Mountaineers. Trying to head towards the sideline to stop the clock.
Look at that. Great job by Justin Ellis. He's tied up by Cooper Hodges, the right tackle. So when you get stalemated, your job is to throw your arms up in the air and see if you can bat down a pass. That's exactly what Ellis was able to do right there. Run it out there to Malik Williams. No blocking for him, and Baker gets him on the ground at the 17. Clock continues to run. Now it's third down. And now, let's see, the Eagles. Now the Eagles are going to try to get the ball back.
Timeout. Georgia Southern. They're first of the half.
Unsure as to why they would call a timeout. Just to talk things over, but, you know, they could have let the clock run right there and taken more time off from the Mountaineers.
I think Georgia Southern now is feeling like they can get the ball back and maybe get good field position out of this because it's now third down and eight. They need just one more stop on this third down, and they're going to force App to punt it away and still have plenty of time to maybe get a field goal out of that.
Well, here's the thing. The Mountaineers have been very efficient on third down conversions so far compared to Georgia Southern. 5 of 9 compared to the Eagles. 0 of 4.
Yep.
Like I said before, App State can't go for a lengthy drive here. So expect a mid-level pass or maybe the home run play. They had three wide receivers on the left side. Also Hennigan all alone on the right.
Third and eight right here. This is typically where they find their tight end. Instead, they run it. Stopped at the 20-yard line. No running room whatsoever. Now let's see the Eagles use a timeout after Peoples gets stopped.
Georgia
Southern is going to get the ball back. It's fourth down with 1:16 left on the clock.
Back-to-back three and outs, and right there, Peoples had nowhere to go. You know, it's Todd Bradley going in. Also, returning in tonight's game, C.J. Wright. Missed the last couple of games.
Yeah, C.J. Wright was one of the players that had been suspended indefinitely a couple of weeks ago after running with the law. But he has served his suspension, and now he's back out there. We were told he's going to maybe play 20-25% of the snaps here tonight. So that's good to see that C.J. Wright is back on the football field. That was a big hit by Todd Bradley. You got to feel really good for him. A guy whose career has taken kind of the long way around with the injuries, the cancer going back to high school, and now here getting a chance to be a starter the last 3 weeks of the season. Caleb Hood standing deep for the Eagles. Georgia Southern should get good field position out of this. And Hood retreating to the 34-yard line, makes the catch right there. So Georgia Southern goes on offense, 70 seconds left in the half, one timeout remaining. And they probably need to get about 40 to 45 yards to get in reasonable range for Rainer.
The question is, who are the Eagles going to go to move the ball downfield that far?
They have not shown a whole lot of effectiveness so far. Limited sample size for Miller Moseley so far at quarterback since replacing the injured Justin Tomlin.
3 carries for just 5 yards since coming in.
Got to get the ball in the hands of your playmakers. They go empty backfield right here. Moseley going to fake the run and go deep and throws in traffic and incomplete. Flag out. Caleb Hood was the intended target, and we might have pass interference here on the Mountaineers as Trey Cobb was shaken up a little bit on the play.
Pass interference. Defense, number 7, 15-yard penalty, automatic, first down.
That was the linebacker back on the coverage.
And you know Doug Roos, the interim offensive coordinator, has to be going deep in the playbook to figure things out. It's been a unique two games for him since taking over for Bob the Best.
Yeah, you're the offensive coordinator, and you don't get shy words to work with. It's just the luck of the, or the unlucky draw, you might say.
Gives you a chance to be creative here.
Yeah, hopefully Wirtz can come back for a bowl game, but the bowl game's only going to be a couple of weeks from now, if that.
Right.
Mosley sprinting and throwing and incomplete. Emile Smith caught it out of bounds. If he caught it at all, he was already out of bounds. So third down now. Or second down, pardon me. Following the penalty, it was back to first down.
But Mosley being a pass-first quarterback rather than a run-first quarterback, you see them trying to open up the playbook for some passing plays, going empty backfield and doing it yet again. Have Logan Wright on the far left side as well.
Second down and 10. Mosley going to run it right up the middle. And DeMarco Jackson grabs him, but a first down run by Miller Mosley.
The chippiness right there is Jackson getting into it, Mosley and a couple of other players.
Well, that caught him by surprise.
Go to trick plays. Empty backfield. They're expecting a pass. The middle of the field opens up, and Mosley able to go right through. Had a block as well from Caleb Kelly.
Probably need another 15 yards to be in field goal range right here. And Logan Wright gets tripped up by Trey Cobb right at the line of scrimmage. Falls forward for about 3 yards. Clock continues to run. 31 seconds. They do have one timeout remaining, likely saving that for the field goal. Throws behind Darion Anderson at the 28.
In this situation, you want to get in field goal range. So being third and seven and knowing what a power back Logan Wright is, he's being taken out at the moment. So if anything, they need to get at least a couple of yards forward to get Alex Rayner in a good position for a field goal.
So third down and seven, ball at the 37. 25 seconds left in the half. Eagles trying to tack on a field goal at least here before the end of the second quarter. Mosley dumps it off to Cam Brown. Cam Brown inside the 20-yard line gets the ball in field goal range for the Eagles. How about that? Two catches for Cam Brown in this game.
That's always an option, too. Going to tight end, sweeping through the middle of the field. Gets the first down and then some. So now the chance for Georgia Southern to score a touchdown. They have 18 seconds and one timeout left.
Take a couple of shots at the end zone right here. Instead, they hand off to Gerald Green. He's down to the 15-yard line, and let's see, they're just going to run it down and kick a field goal. So the Eagles let it wind on down to 3-2 and use the timeout.
Timeout, Georgia Southern. Their third and final time of the half, 30-second timeout.
So they ran the ball there to put it on the right hash for Alex Rayner.
Now all Rayner has to do is connect on the shot.
How about both these coaches burning up their timeouts in the last 2 minutes of this half to try to squeeze a few more points out of the quarter? App State used their timeouts. They thought they could get it back and get a score here. They got stopped three and out. Georgia Southern was the team that was able to turn it around and put themselves in position to score. This will be a 33-yard attempt for Alex Rayner.
Solid defense on both sides the last couple of drives. Rayner missed a field goal last week against Florida Atlantic when only made one, excuse me.
So Eagles have gone six plays, 50 yards, in 68 seconds to set up this attempt by Rayner.
Seems we went 2 of 3.
Kick is on its way, and the kick is going to be good. 33-yard field goal by Alex Rayner as the clock hits zero. And Georgia Southern, a 10-point lead, heading to the locker room. Nicely done by the Eagles' clock management. 10-point lead for the Georgia Southern Eagles here at halftime. Start of the second half in Statesboro on a lovely Saturday night, less than 2 weeks from Christmas, and Georgia Southern trying to put a bow on their 2020 regular season with a third consecutive victory over App State, their rivals, 17-7 as we head to the third.
And after this game for Georgia Southern, they'll be the second team in FBS to play a 12-game season, and that really needs to be praised a lot from Chad Lundgren and this Georgia Southern organization, just being able to stay healthy throughout the season, managing to pull a 12-game schedule, even for Appalachian State, who had some COVID issues in the beginning of the year, but they've gone over 70 days with no positive test at all. So a big testament to both of these teams being able to have a lengthy schedule where you see other programs in the Power Five that are struggling at this moment. Props to the Sun Belt overall. So Chad Lunsford, it'll be unique to see what they do in the second half. Same with Sean Clark for Appalachian State.
So 10-point lead for the Eagles, as they will be kicking off to the Mountaineers to start this third quarter. And it looks like Alex Rayner is going to take the kickoff here. And Chad Lunsford said this was a possibility when we spoke to him early in the week. And going back to our conversation in the first half, Danny, still looking for that guy that can get the ball to the end zone for the touchback.
Right. Over the years, the Eagles have been very fortunate to have some great kickers come through their programs. Tyler Bass, Young Wei Koo, and with Rayner and Dylan Lewis. Lewis, a freshman. Rayner, a redshirt freshman. They'll have time to develop. So still plenty of options on what they want to do with their kicking game.
Kick taken at the two by Virgil, who has the one touchdown for the Mountaineers in this game. He gets dragged down from behind by Ferguson at the 28-yard line, and that's where the Mountaineers will start on offense to begin this third quarter.
And they've been able to get some carries in the running game. Cameron Peoples, 10 rushes for 33 yards. He's been the primary guy they hand the ball off to, but in order to really get him in a position, they got to start on the passing game. And you may see Zach Thomas here on this drive go for a few more passes to his senior receivers, even his tight end as well, in order to open that up. And it worked on their 17-play drive back in the first half.
Peoples gets the first carry of the third quarter, and he cracks it out there for a 7-yard gain to the 34-yard line. So Peoples, on his 11th carry, goes up over 40 yards for the game.
Good job by Ephraim Kitchen. A return last week and would come in for the tackle.
Zach Thomas, 12 of 21 passing for 116 yards. The touchdown to Virgil and the pick six to Spaulding. Second down and four. And Peoples' big run out across the 40-yard line, stiff-arming Kitchen. And out to the 48, and that's a first down run for Peoples.
Niners going the other way around instead, using their running game to open things up. That time, Peoples able to bounce to the outside. It's a good run, able to follow the blockers, getting a first down.
So the Mountaineers have moved it 20 yards from the 28 out to the 48. And a good start to their third quarter. Thomas, quick fire to the far sideline to Hennigan, slips out of one tackle, and Hennigan down to the 45-yard line. He got seven on the play.
And Hennigan's been the go-to guy so far for the Mountaineers. Six catches now, over 50 yards receiving tonight.
He is such a tough receiver, especially in traffic, specializes in those screens, those bubble and tunnel screens. Got to be a top hombre to get in there and mix it up, especially when you're running into those lanes where linebackers typically are. Noel with the carry picks up the first down at the 41-yard line, and so bam, 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 Adam moving the ball down the field.
And giving the freshman Noel a carry for a couple of yards, and you're right, you got to be a tough guy to passes, especially with the Eagles running a 3-4 defense, so you got to worry about an extra linebacker back there looking to take your head off.
Keep your head on a swivel at the same time. First and 10, ball at the 41-yard line. Noel got hit right away by Jose. Ben's Jose with the tackle.
That's another beauty of the 3-4 for the Eagles, because you can line up a basic 3-4, but you can have one or two of your linebackers blitz. That's how they've been able to get a couple of sacks, having those two outside guys tail in. It really adds pressure on the offensive line trying to stop that coverage.
Josue, the defensive player of the week for the Eagles last week in the vote of the defensive coaches. No gain on that play, second down and 10. Thomas, pressure's coming. He's going to run away from it. Now take off and pick up the first down at the 30 and more, and all the way down to the 21-yard line.
And that was close.
And it doesn't look like he's moving that fast. In fact, it kind of looks like he's moving in slow motion, but he finds the running lanes. And Noel picks up about two on the play.
More than anything, it's the awareness from Thomas able to get through as we have.
Well, he doesn't panic, that's for one thing. When the pressure comes and it's all around him, he doesn't panic.
That's where your senior leadership steps in for Thomas.
So they will take that penalty. So it'll be first and 5. They're going to spot it at the 17-yard line. And that will be the first penalty of the ball game against Georgia Southern.
Referee's mic wasn't on, but saying it was an offsides on the defense.
All right, go ahead.
So now he's got his mic on. So first and 5, following the penalty. Quick pass to their tight end, and that's going to be a first down catch and run by Henry Pearson.
And one thing you also have to take into consideration with Zach Thomas, as we talked about, the leadership and how experienced he is, and how he has 30 wins under his belt as quarterback for the Mountaineers. That's one shy from Trevor Lawrence.
Noel on the carry, picks up two down to the 9.
Sub coming in.
Impressive drive, 7 plays, 62 yards now.
Set again.
For App State as they've moved from their 28. And they've done most of it on the ground. 45 of the now 63 yards have come on the ground for the Mountaineers on this drive. In fact, they have more yards rushing on this drive than they had the entire first half. Thomas to the air, and Noel back in the end zone and just letting too much. That's a tougher pass than you might initially think. You see Noel, he's open, you're like, why can't you hit him? Because you got to throw it over the defenders there.
That and Noel getting tripped up at the end, but the pass from Thomas was too strong. Definitely led him, but throwing it almost out of bounds.
Mountaineers 5 of 10 on third down here. This is a 3rd and 9. Third and goal from the 9. Pressure, throwing, touchdown Hennigan. Mountaineers on the board again at 17-13.
Great find. Eagles showing pressure up front. Thomas able to get it out in time, finding a slanting Hennigan. Just like that, the Mountaineers back in this game on a solid opening drive to start the second half.
A 72-yard drive, 10 plays, 4 minutes. Staten on for the PAT to try to make it a field goal game again, which he does. So App State takes the opening kickoff and marches right down the field, most of that coming on the ground, but capped on the 9-yard touchdown pass from Thomas to Hennigan. 17-14 in the third. App State and Georgia Southern, between them, 9 national championships. The Eagles winning their first in 1985, their most recent in 2000. App State, 2006 through 8, 3 straight national titles.
A lot of success in both programs, of course, with Georgia Southern and Irk Russell making this program what it is today. Russell winning 3 of those 6 championships, and for Appalachian State in the mid-2000s, winning 3 in a row. Mountaineer fans remember September 1st, 2007, the big upset over Michigan as well in that championship. Success to the Sun Belt, Georgia Southern, first year in the Sun Belt, 2014, winning the conference championship. And the Mountaineers, even though they're only playing for a conference championship this season, played in the championship game the last 4 years.
Yeah, this is just the second time since Georgia Southern and App State joined the Sun Belt that one of them hasn't won the Sun Belt Championship.
Just shows what they've been able to add to this conference.
And Caleb Hood is in there at quarterback. Direct snap right to him. We were told that this was a possibility, and he picks up about 3 yards on the play.
We'll see how much they decide to use Caleb Hood on these snaps. That time going up the middle, able to get 4 yards.
Well, they got Miller Mosley back in there now, so I think they're going to kind of juggle this. But obviously, Caleb Hood brings an athletic dimension to that quarterback position that Miller Mosley can't. Handoff goes to Logan Wright. He gets bottled up, about a 1 yard gain. Not a lot of running room for Logan Wright, just 6 carries for 13 or 14 yards after that gain right there.
Given the situation that Georgia Southern is in right now, they're going to have to come up with some unique decisions on how they want to move the ball downfield. Yes, you can go direct snap to Caleb Hood, but you have to get guys like Logan Wright and Matt LaRoche heavily involved.
3rd and 4, Eagles, 1 of 5 on thirds in the game. Mosley with the pocket. Fires got batted down, and the big guy, Demetrius Taylor, swatted it out of the air.
This will be a challenging second half for the Eagles on offense. A tremendous job from Taylor getting his hand up, deflecting the ball.
Did you see the hang time by him? He just he jumped into the air and just kind of paused in the air and waited for the pass and then batted it down. What athleticism by the 6'1", 295 senior out of Miami Northwestern. High kick. Fair catch is bobbled, and the Eagles might be on top of it inside the 50. Could see him having some difficulty tracking the ball as it was coming down, and Jalen Jackson recovers the fumbled punt for Georgia Southern.
This is the time where you have to make the most out of different sides of the game. This time special teams come to the play.
First down, Georgia Southern.
Just unable to hang on to the fair catch.
Well, that's one way to flip field position. Recover the fumbled punt by Malik Williams, and the Eagles take over 1st and 10 at the App 47. Gerald Green runs tough in there, tackled by Caden Smith. Couple of Atlanta area former high school star, Smith out of Mountain View, and of course Green out of East Coweta.
One thing you want to pay attention to with the Eagles on offense here is how they're lining up Cam Brown, kind of having him in a little fullback role, trying to be an extra blocker to help the Eagle running backs move downfield.
Second down and 5. Malik Murray hasn't had any touches in this game. He was the one in motion. Quarterback sack.
And the ball's out.
And App may be on top of it, and it looks like the Mountaineers have gotten it back. Big Jordan Earl, the nose tackle, ends up with the pigskin. They collapsed the pocket quickly on Mosley.
We saw it happen in the first quarter where both teams traded possessions with interceptions. This time by fumbles, pocket collapsing on Mosley. Sperling.
Yeah, Nick Hampton was the first guy to hit him. Hampton gets the quarterback sack, and Jordan Earl ends up recovering the fumble. And those and the Mountaineer players are over there. They're playing towards their fans over there. They're over there. Their fans are over there cheering.
One thing I saw, I don't know if you saw, you know, the Eagles have a turnover chain. I saw a plunger that the Mountaineers were using.
I haven't ever seen the turnover plunger. That's Hennigan again on the catch. That's his 8th catch of the ball game. They've really used Thomas Hennigan as almost an extension of the run game tonight.
Been able to get him in certain spots, able to make quick catches in situations where it's third and long. He knows where to go and how to run these routes.
That was a 4-yard pickup right there. So now 7-8 that make that 8 catches for 64 yards for Hennigan tonight. Peoples crosses the 50 down to the 48. Going to bring up third down and short for App State.
This is the time when the Mountaineers need to capitalize.
Saw Quinn Williams. Watch him come in on that tackle, just dropping his fist down on that football, trying to knock it loose. But Peoples had it wrapped up securely. Third down and 1. Approaching 7 to play here in the third. App State with a chance on this drive to tie or take the lead. Nothing doing on third down. Got stonewalled, and now they've got a big decision to make from the 48.
If you're App State, I think you should go for it. Considering the Eagles are trying to figure things out on the offensive end, they can rely on their defense to make a stop if they need to. Really fourth and 1. You can go for a run up the middle. Also, a quarterback sneak can do it too.
You can see the ball is at the 48 after Peoples got stopped right there. And you see Birds back in the ball game too for the Eagles. Little pop pass caught for a first down. Pearson down the sideline. Pearson all the way down inside the 20, close to the 15. Nicely executed. Eagles thought run was coming. A little pop pass from Thomas to Pearson.
That's such a dangerous play to make on fourth and 1. Well, the Mountaineers able to execute and got a ton of yards in the process as well.
Wow, what a play by App State. Now they've got it first and 10 at the Eagles 15.
Now more than anything, you're in the red zone. You have a chance for a field goal, but more importantly, you want to get a touchdown to take the lead.
Yeah, I think Mountaineers are thinking touchdown right here as Peoples gets another 5 yards on the play. And that's the thing. The difference in what App has been able to do here in the third quarter as opposed to the first half is run the ball.
Well, they're able to set the tone with that on their first drive.
Thomas takes a sack back at the 18-yard line. Quinn Williams with his second sack of the game and the fourth for Georgia Southern.
The defensive line's done a tremendous job once again. Credit to Vic Cabral and what he's been able to do with these guys. At that time, Williams, one of the outside linebackers, able to get to it. But just the front 7 from Georgia Southern has done a tremendous job putting pressure on Thomas.
So third down and 12. Line to gain is the 5. Eagles with an opportunity to hold App State to a field goal attempt right here. Thomas Thomas weaves through traffic, going to go down at the 16-yard line as Ellis got a piece of his foot and tripped him, and now it's fourth down.
Field goal team coming out. See here, Thomas just nowhere to throw it to, goes up the middle, getting a couple of yards, but this would be a big moment for Chandler Staten to redeem himself because he missed that game tying field goal as time expired against Louisiana last week at home.
33-yard attempt from straight on, dead away, right in the middle of the field. Kick is up and good. We're tied at 17. Staten belts it through from 33 yards, and we're tied at 17. 10 consecutive points for App State here in the third quarter, and we're all even with four to play in the period. Sean Clark was not happy with the officiating on that last series. App State does get a field goal out of it, Danny, and they tie it at 17.
That's the big thing, and you know, emotions are high on both sides, just knowing what this rivalry means to both the programs, and now we're back at all square, 17-all.
Caleb Hood takes a knee, and the Eagles will bring it out to the 25-yard line, and like this series, between these two longtime rivals, tied 3-3 since they both went FBS. We're tied at 17 now with just 19 minutes of regulation left in this game.
Miller Moe's going to stay in a quarterback. It'll be unique to see how the Eagles can move the ball upfield. They got lucky with the fumble on the punt return to get the ball back, but they were stopped yet again. Or they had it turned over.
Yeah, they turned it right back over on the fumble by Mosley when he was quarterback sacked. Running option, and Mosley going to pick up about 9 yards on the play. Ryan Huff, the free safety, making the tackle, but a nice run by Mosley. They're going to give him the first down and say he got 10. Spotted at the 35.
Good run, a fake up the middle to Green. This is where Mosley can take advantage of that, those fake handoffs with the option.
Mosley now 7 carries for 35 yards in the game. And again, he's quarterbacking because Justin Tomlin was lost to a knee injury. Gerald Green on the near sideline as Caden Smith makes the tackle. But that's going to be close to a first down run right there.
One thing we haven't really seen from the offense from Georgia Southern is the pitch out to the other running back. So it's possible that if Mosley can do that a little bit more, setting up his running backs in a position to move the ball upfield, the Eagles can get some good spots.
Second down, and Logan Wright gets the first down close to it. I believe he got it at the 45-yard line. He did when he was tackled by Frizzell.
You got to remember, Georgia Southern had this same issue last week against Florida Atlantic with some rough drives. They didn't score an offensive touchdown until the fourth quarter. They were able to score a little bit in the first half, but they may be caught in the same predicament here.
First and 10 from the 45. A couple of first downs already on this drive. Pass is complete to Pelkison, the tight end. First career catch for Sean Pelkison.
First time for everything for the freshman Pelkison, getting mainly reps this season on special teams. And the Eagles have had to go through a couple of tight ends. A few of them got hurt. Bo Johnson, who had 2 touchdowns, out for the year. Also, Chase Hancock, who suffered an injury midway through. So guys like Pelkison, DJ Butler, Cam Brown, who's been starting, getting an opportunity to prove themselves.
4 plays, 30 yards, 3 first downs for Georgia Southern since taking over at their own 25-yard line. And the carry by Mosley right there, tackled by Nick Hampton. And Mosley got 3 on the play, as it's now going to be 2nd down and 7 from the App 42. Shaping up for a great fourth quarter here in this rivalry game.
For the Eagles offense, as long as you can get 3 to 4 yard plays, you're making great progression, also taking time off the clock.
Under 2 minutes to play in the third. Mosley running option again and running hard, picks up the first down. So Mosley showing his moxie here, and he's a tough runner. Picks up the first down.
I think he could have gotten a touchdown if he just didn't get tripped up from behind. There you see, good block. Just a shoestring tackle from Caden Smith, yeah. And I believe that if both would have broken that, he could have gotten the Eagles at least in the red zone.
First and 10 from the 32. 43 yards now since they started this drive, and they've covered it in just six plays. Cam Brown in motion, the tight end, already has a couple of catches in this game. And the handoff to Jaylen White. First time we've seen Jaylen White carry in this ball game, and he gets stopped for very little gain. Caden Smith came up from the safety spot to help out Demetrius Taylor on the tackle, 1 yard pickup.
That was the 11th carry on the season for Jaylen White. Couldn't really get past the lineman, collided behind Aaron Dowdell, and couldn't bounce outside the way he intended to.
He's a big freshman running back, too. At 6 foot, 205, Doug Roosh was telling us this week, reminds you a lot of one of those old eye running backs that you just don't see anymore. Second down and 8. And tripped up. I don't know whether he tripped on his own 2 feet or tripped over the linebacker, Trey Cobb. Either way, picked up just a yard on the play. Now third down and long as we go under 30 seconds to play in the quarter.
It looks like they're going to get this last play off, or they might just let the clock run down.
They don't have to. It's just a matter of do they want to run another play, and it doesn't look like they want to.
Yeah, I think in the situation, just let the clock run out, go into the fourth quarter, have some time in between the break to think about what you want to do, because if you can't get the first down, you want to get Alex Rayner in a good position for a field goal.
And that is the end of the third quarter here
in Ballston.
Should be a great fourth quarter. We're tied at 17 here in Statesboro. Heading to the fourth quarter here at Paulson. Matt Stewart along with Danny Waugh. Here's a look at the latest bowl projections. Georgia Southern to the New Orleans Bowl to play Louisiana Tech. App State, UAB in the Myrtle Beach Bowl.
And we'll see how these projections stand following this game. It just shows with six teams from the Sun Belt and with four of them out of the East Division, it shows how kind of the Sun Belt has carried the college football season. You got to give credit to Keith Gill and what he's been able to do.
Mosley on third down, incomplete to Cam Brown. So now it's fourth down and a long field goal attempt coming up here by Alex Rayner.
Well, this is the right decision. Get ahead, and it's been a rough outing for the Eagles defense in the second half. The Mountaineers able to score on two separate occasions in the third quarter, a touchdown and a field goal. This one a 47-yard attempt.
From the right hash to give Georgia Southern the lead. Kick is on its way, and the kick is going to be good. Alex Rayner from 47 yards, and the Eagles are back on top. 9 seconds into the fourth quarter, Georgia Southern reclaims the lead. App on offense when we get back. Alex Rayner with his 47-yard field goal, second field goal of the night. Eagles have gotten a pick six from David Spaulding. 15-yard touchdown run from Justin Tomlin, who's no longer in the ball game, and lead App by 3 as we start basically the fourth quarter.
And what a big-time field goal from Rayner. He was 2 of 6 hitting field goals between 40 and 49 yards, and he hadn't made a field goal 40 yards or more since Texas State. Since then, he missed a 52, a 48, and a 47-yarder against Florida Atlantic, so it has to be a big confidence booster for the redshirt freshman kicker.
Virgil out across the 40, now the 50. Got a way to go. There he goes. Virgil is going to take it to the house. A 100-yard kick return touchdown by Virgil after he fielded the kickoff over his head.
Special teams may be the X factor in one of these teams getting the victory. Just great blocking. Virgil already with a touchdown reception tonight. And now a kick return, 100 yards to go along with it. And the Mountaineers get their first lead of the night.
Wow. And he fielded that kick over his head like it was a line drive. I think everybody was kind of stunned that he even brought it out. He was right there at the goal line. It was going over his head. And he goes 100 for the score. Now Chandler State will try to make it a four-point game, which he does. Wow. Mountaineers on top for the first time tonight after trailing by as much as 14 points. Jalen Virgil, young man playing back in his home state of Georgia from Mountain View High School in the Atlanta area, just houses this kick return, takes it 101 yards, and the point I wanted to make was you saw that line drive kick. There was no air under that kick, which allowed for this great return.
And then another point right there, just great blocking as well from the Mountaineers. Gabe Montgomery really made that key block to give Virgil a chance for some space on the outside, and the Eagles unable to replicate that on the other side for the Eagles.
Now contrast that kick with the one you just saw from App State and the kick by Riker right here. Riker Casey, that had such loft underneath it. Caleb Hood fields that thing, does not have an opportunity to get a great return like Jalen Virgil had on the line drive kick from Rayner.
Now for the Eagles offense, you're at a deficit here. So the question is, how do you work your way back through?
And you have to do it with your third team quarterback. And Gerald Green runs up to the 27-yard line and picks up about six on that play.
You'll see the Eagles go through multiple running backs. This time Gerald Green moving right back there now for second and four.
But the nuances of the game, and we talked about this with Chad Lunsford this week, the nuances of the game and throwaway play and the difference on the two kickoffs just back-to-back, and you saw the result is vastly different. The touchdown for App and the short return for the Eagles. Ball is up in the air and nearly intercepted by Caden Smith trying to get the ball to Pelkison, and did they throw a flag? I don't think they did.
No flag called, but adding on to what you said, what Chad Lunsford talked about for this game, special teams, you can't just take off. The Mountaineers have made some great special teams plays. And also for the other side of Georgia Southern, Caleb Hood had a punt return touchdown last week against Florida Atlantic. Just never know when special teams will come into play and really make or break a game for you.
Third down and four. Ball at the 27. Mountaineers showing pressure. They're bringing it on the option. Mosley got hit in the backfield and dropped for a loss. Finished off by Brendan Harrington.
You're really starting to see the momentum shift. It's been all Mountaineers in the second half. Demetrius Taylor got a hand on it on Mosley, and Brendan Harrington, who already had an interception, with the finishing touches.
So fourth down and five, punting situation right here for the Eagles as they go three and out after the 100-yard kick return by Virgil. And Beck has had a great game. High kick, fielded at the 30-yard line, and that's where the Mountaineers will go back on offense and some pushing and shoving going on the punt coverage teams.
More importantly, Williams secured the ball. Didn't want to have a mishap like last time.
You see, that was a three and out, 5 yards, and this is where you've got to watch if you are the Georgia Southern defense and try to defend and protect against a long 7-minute drive like App State had earlier in this game.
Still plenty of time for the Eagles, however, the defense have made some good stops before. They have to step up here again.
Noel off to the races. He's in the open. Man, he's going to go. No one's close to him. Nate Noel takes it to the house on a 70-yard touchdown run. Wow. 100-yard kick return and now a 70-yard touchdown run by Nate Noel. And App State has turned this game upside down.
Justin, I talked about how the Eagles defense needed to get a key stop here. The freshman Nate Noel out of Miami almost untouched, followed his blockers and took it to the house. And this has been all Mountaineers throughout this second half. This after this PAT, it'll be 24 points by App State in the second half alone.
And 31-20 as Staten puts it through. Wow, nobody was near Nate Noel. 11-point lead for the Mountaineers. App State has outscored Georgia Southern 24-3 here in the second half to turn upside down what was a 17-7 deficit for them and now lead 11 points with just under 13 minutes to play here. Wow, what a stunning turn of events. Two huge plays back-to-back. And the kick's going to be taken at the 5-yard line by Caleb Hood. And again, Hood gets stopped at the 15-yard line. I hate to belabor the point as Nicholas Ross makes the tackle, but you see the difference in the kick coverage and the high kicks there by Riker Casey has consistently left Georgia Southern with poor field position. If you can't kick it into the end zone to get the touchback, get the high loft on the kick and pin the opponent deep in their own territory.
But one thing you haven't really seen from the Eagles offense here in the second half as well, they haven't really been able to move the ball forward.
Yep.
I mean, the botched punt return really put them in a good position, and that resulted in just a field goal.
Eagles have been held to 231 yards of total offense in this game. 181 of that on the ground, and now Mosley going to the air over here and intercepted by Caden Smith at the 37-yard line. And things have come apart quickly here in Statesboro.
Interception by the defense. First down, Appalachian State.
What a play. Caden Smith with the interception and a spectacular defensive play to go up and get that ball.
I mean, it was almost 1-on-4 at that point. Just a swarm of Mountaineers around Malik Murray.
Now, if you're the Eagles defense, you've got to be on red alert here because I would not be surprised if the Mountaineers don't take a shot at the end zone right here themselves.
Got to keep that momentum up.
Zach Thomas going to run it, and he gets tripped up by Wilson after a pickup of about 5 on the play.
And this is right here where senior leadership just steps into play. It's Thomas keeping it himself, getting 5 yards, and now you can definitely just tell the difference from playing down, playing from behind, to playing ahead. The confidence is there on the App State offense. They have the Eagles where they want them at this point. They've had so many different key plays on each side of the ball, special teams, offense, and then defense with the pick.
This game was 17-17 when we started the fourth quarter. Noel going to be dropped for a loss. Birdsong got him behind the line of scrimmage, and then Wade helped out. And now it's going to be third down. Second TFL of the night for Birdsong.
I was going to see Birdsong back in. He was shaken up a little bit earlier in the game. He was taken to the medical tent. Seems to be okay. Able to get a great stop. And defense for the Eagles just needs to step up here. And, you know, there's still plenty of time to go. You just have to try to make that stop. And it starts here with your defense.
Well, you definitely cannot allow App State to score a touchdown in this situation. A field goal would be a great victory for the Eagles out of the hands of Peoples. And so now it's going to be fourth down, and this would be a long field goal attempt by Staten.
I say go for it. I mean, if you hit the field goal, it's already a two-possession game, but if you nail the field goal here, you go up by 14. There's also a chance the Mountaineers are going to just keep their offense out there and go for a fourth down. If they don't get it, their defense just made a great stop in the series prior.
Yeah. Yeah, this would be, if they had tried it, a 50-yard field goal attempt. So they keep Zach Thomas and the offense out there for fourth down and 5. And it's a quick kick. No, they don't. They're just going to pin them. And somehow why that was fielded by Kitchen right there. But fortunately, the Eagles don't cough it up. But that was a huge, dangerous play by Ephraim Kitchen right there to field that ball inside the 10-yard line. And you see Chad Lunsford wants an explanation. Indeed he does.
Yeah, in that situation, you got to let the ball go. I mean, take another look here. It's a quick kick from Thomas. And Kitchen was running in and just ended up.
I think it just kind of hopped up.
Right.
And he's running, and all of a sudden the ball is in front of him. So he had to do something, and he grabbed it, as it turns out. And that's a great play for the Mountaineers because they pinned the Eagles back at the 3-yard line. Off goes to right, maybe 2 yards on the play. It's been a tough night for him after back-to-back really big games. Now 8 carries, less than 20 yards for him this evening.
He hasn't really had many opportunities to run the ball, as we've seen in previous games, where Logan Wright, as we talked about, was really a key factor in the Eagles' offense in their victory over Florida Atlantic last Saturday.
So 2nd down and 7, ball at the 5. And Mosley going to cut it up and run it himself. And he gets it up to the 10 as he picks up 5 yards on the play. And a scuffle going on out of bounds over there by the 5-yard line, and they finally break it up.
Mosley able to break through a few tackles, but ran right into Harrington. But more than anything, positive yardage for the Eagles to give the offense some space.
3rd down now. They've got to get this 3rd down. They've only converted 1 the entire night. As we're now under 10 to play, they're 2 possessions down. They've got to get this conversion. Mosley going to run it and run into his own man. And he's going to be close to the 1st down, but I don't know if he got it or not. Let's see where they spot it. He had to get to about the 13. And I think he got it. They might measure.
Right now it says
they gave him the 1st down.
I'll say for a moment there, it looked like it was going to be 4th and short,
yep.
But they do get the 1st. So a big break. And you see over on the sideline, you just saw Sean Clark just running down to one of the officials, just upset with the ball placement. Really thought his defense was going to force a 3 and out.
So 1st and 10, ball at the 13-yard line. Mosley going deep and dropped by Thompson. That's unfortunate. That should have been a big play for the Eagles right there. Mosley put it right on the money.
Yeah, and you're seeing the Eagles start to go for these deep passes, and that was a good throw from Mosley. And if you gotta catch that. That was right in the hand, just could not bring it down.
That's a nightmare for a wide receiver right there. He'll have a sleepless night over that one. 2nd down and 10. Following the drop, that should have been midfield for the Eagles, at least. Mosley on the keeper gets slung to the ground at the 26-yard line. Hampton has had himself a very active game, making the tackle for the Mountaineers.
Mosley that time able to fake out Nick Hampton and break that tackle and get a couple of yards. Only 3 there on the play.
Hampton now with 7 tackles and a quarterback sack in this game. It's 3rd down and 7, and the clock is slipping away here. Mosley guns it to this near side. Looked like there was contact. And did they rule a catch or not? That was Jolly on the coverage. And Smith did not make the catch. It's fourth down. And the Eagles have to punt.
More than anything, Matt, just the pressure that the defense made. You saw they sent the house. Really trying to put pressure on Mosley. And I don't think the catch, yeah, possession looked close. But Anthony Beck has done a great job with some really long punts.
Yeah, he's 5 for a 45-yard average in this game. He's had two that are 50-plus. Spiraling kick taken by Malik Williams at the 37-yard line. And that's where App State will go on offense when we get back. And now with an 11-point lead, they can burn some clock. It has been all App State here in the second half, outscoring the Eagles 24-3, turning a 17-7 halftime deficit into an 11-point lead. Matt Stewart along with Danny Wan. Danny, I expect the Mountaineers to try to run some clock here.
Run some clock and get one more touchdown to seal this one, because you have to remember, this is something that's been brewing on the Mountaineers for a while, losing the last two matchup the previous 2 years. But it won't work like that when you have Peoples running into his own lineman.
Tackled by Dylan Springer. And not just losses the last 2 years, but really costly losses to Georgia Southern the last 2 years. When they were ranked in the polls last year, when they had a shot at the New Year's Day 6 Bowl, and the Eagles gave them their only loss of the season. So in that regard, you're right. There's some payback, no doubt, on their minds, since especially this game is about bragging rights with no championship on the line for either team. Peoples with a big hole spins up to the 44-yard line as Birdsong came up from the safety spot to make the tackle. And it's going to be third down and about four.
Bad time, Peoples. Able to find an opening. Great tackle by Birdsong. And for the Mountaineers, it's a different pace now. No pressure for them.
Yeah. Peoples now 17 carries and 69 yards. You can see the play clock ticking down by the game clock. Let's see how far they take it down before they snap the ball. Probably at least five. And that's exactly where they snap it. Oh, wow. Peoples got hit hard at the line of scrimmage. Big defensive stop right there as Todd Bradley helps the Eagles get the ball back with that tackle.
Yeah, he got stuck, and the Eagles aren't out of this yet. They still have an opportunity. They just have to get their offense going. And we'll see if they can do that here on the next possession. Just great job by Bradley. Just stuck Peoples.
And Springer was in on that play, too. He's at the bottom of the pile. He blew up the offensive line, which allowed Bradley to come in from the linebacker spot and make the tackle. Sabach is on the kick for the Mountaineers. They wind the clock all the way down to two before they snap it. And Caleb Hood, not much of a return. That's been a big difference in this ball game. The special teams for App State, just the subtle things, the air they get under their kicks, really limits returns. Eagles have not had a whole lot of return yardage in this game. In fact, the Eagles have had only 53 yards of kick returns and only 8 yards of punt returns. And that's on 6 punts in this game. So back on offense, the Eagles, and time running out. They got to get 2 scores here. And Logan Wright battles his way up to the 22 on the play. And actually, when you say they got to get 2 scores, they really got to get 3 scores, because I count the 2-point conversion, the difficulty of that play, I count that as another score. You really got to get 3 scores to tie.
Yeah, and I think at this point, you said keep on giving it to your power back and Logan Wright.
Ball in the air, and it's caught by Carter. He's got a lane. Off to the races, and Dexter Carter's going to score the touchdown for Georgia Southern. And the Eagles are right back in it.
That's all it takes. This time going for the pass, able to find Dexter Carter. And just like that, it's a one-possession game, so you may see things change. It's a good find to Carter with his first touchdown on the year.
A 78-yard touchdown pass, and now I'm guessing the Eagles go for two here to try to get to within a field goal.
Timeout. Georgia Southern. They're first
Georgia
to half.
Southern burns a timeout. This is a
timeout.
Huge two-point conversion, so if you're not square on what you want to be doing here, you need to burn that timeout because this is a huge play.
Absolutely. Finally, it seems like the Eagles were able to find an opening on the offense after really unable to move the ball downfield on multiple possessions throughout this second half.
I'm trying to figure out what happened on this touchdown. I mean, there were like three guys right around Dexter Carter, and it's almost as if the others were looking at each other like, I thought you had him.
It was a big-time two-point conversion.
Look at this.
Here.
You got, there's a guy, there's a guy.
I think Ryan Huff, the way he stepped in, just wasn't in a position to make a tackle, and Carter able to run through.
That was Gene Charles and Huff right there, and they kind of, neither one of them had a chance, and Dexter Carter put on the Jets. Now the two-point conversion try here. Mosley going to throw it back, and incomplete. Cam Brown was that target, and it's 31-26, so the Eagles going to have to score another touchdown.
So here's the situation. You have two timeouts remaining. You don't have to use them at this particular time. You still trust your defense to get another three and out. And hopefully there's still some time left on the clock for your offense to produce.
Well, here's where that failed two-point conversion doubly hurts you, because you used one of your timeouts that, being down, you really need to use defensively while App State has the ball to try to get the ball back. And you didn't get the points. So now you're going to have to score a touchdown the next time you have it.
You wonder as well if Georgia Southern might go for some trickery here, maybe an onside kick. I mean, there's 5:23 left, so it's not the necessary thing you need to do.
Yeah, I think it's too early to try the onside kick, and it has become such a low percentage play. It's just really difficult to execute now. So let's see what they do. Rainer's going to be the one kicking it.
Well, we've seen him get it back to the end zone on the last one, but it resulted in a kick return for a touchdown.
The big thing was it was a line drive kick. You got to get air underneath the ball. And a little bit more air under the ball this time. That's a better kick taken at the 6, and they call a fair catch. And so it'll come out to the 25. But you see the difference in that kick. The last time, Rainer was trying to kick it to the end zone to get that touchback, and he sacrificed height on the ball for distance, and it cost him on that kick return. That time, a better kick as he angled it and got air underneath it and forced him into a touchback.
There was some chippiness there for a moment after the play was over. We'll see if the Mountaineer offense can take some more time off the clock or if the Eagles can make a great stop on the defensive side. Just shows that it ain't over until it's over, Matt.
App State back on offense with a 5-point lead. Handoff goes to Noel. He has a 70-yard touchdown run in this game. Quinn Williams, first guy to hit him. Quinn Williams just had a really good game. That dog backer spot, a couple of sacks tonight. Coach Sloan really loves him. He's really long. 6'3", 260. He's huge, and he's long. Got long arms. He can really make some plays out there.
Well, all four of the outside linebackers, along with Williams, Randy Wade, Vince Hoseway, and Reed Dedman, have all just made contributable efforts on the defensive side for the Eagles.
Second down and 7 from the 29. They're going to go to the air, and they're going to go for a home run. And it's going to be caught at the 40-yard line and a flag out. Jalen Virgil again playing in his home state has had a huge game tonight.
A receiving touchdown, a kick return touchdown, and here you see just able to fight past Daryl Baker. Got his arms out, makes the catch, and there's going to be some extra yards added to that with the pass interference.
Pass
that
interference.
Was an outstanding defense. Reception by
apparently
Jalen Virgil right
there. The result of the play is a first down.
So let's see where they end up spotting this ball. They marked it down at the 38. That was a 33-yard completion to Virgil.
Keep in mind, the clock continuing to wind down. Now under 4.5 minutes to play in the fourth.
Wow. Nate Noel is like a bolt of lightning. He hits that hole and goes. That's another first down for App. And Noel goes over 100 yards rushing on that carry right there, his 10th carry of the night. Pardon me, he's at 10 for 95, not quite there yet. And 70 of it coming on that back-breaking touchdown run in the fourth quarter.
Well, Noel and Cameron Peoples have just done a solid job on the running game and really helping out here in the second half.
Noel gets wrapped up. Rashad Bird is right there to stop him in his tracks.
It's a great job up the middle. Bird read it exactly how he intended to. And Quinn Williams adding on to the stop as well.
That's the big difference in my mind for App State in the second half is their ability to run the ball. I think they had like 37 yards rushing at halftime, and they're up to 177 now. Second down and 9, under 3 to go. Noel again. Wilson comes up from the safety spot to hit him at the 24, and that's going to leave them about 6 yards shy of the first down, and I believe Georgia Southern used their second timeout.
Second
they did.
Great job by Wilson, able to hang on for the tackle. And
30 seconds.
That was going to be my next question. At what point, if you're Chad Lunsford, do you start to call your timeouts? And he does so right here, knowing that the Mountaineers are in field goal range.
Yeah. Well, you've played your card. Now you've got to get the stop, because if they pick up a first down on this next run, game over pretty much. You'll only have one timeout remaining. And if they can't run it all the way down, they can run it virtually all the way down.
If they hit a field goal, it makes it an 8-point game, and that's where the 2-point conversion attempt from Georgia Southern after the previous touchdown by Dexter Carter really comes into effect.
College football semifinals coming up on New Year's Day, the Rose Bowl at 5 o'clock Eastern, followed by the All-State Sugar Bowl. Who will be the final four in? Alabama, Clemson, Notre Dame, Ohio State. Those are the guys in position right now. Third down and 5. Noel is going to be dropped at the 20, about 2 yards short of the first down, and Georgia Southern just used their last timeout.
So, you know, for the college football playoff, even though we have our four right now, it's still so uncertain on who's really going to advance, because championship weekend next week has some serious implications, because you have Clemson and Notre Dame in the ACC championship, Alabama
Florida
against Florida, Ohio State, well, some think they shouldn't be in it.
Well, they changed the rules this week so that they could be in the Big Ten championship game. So now fourth down and 2. Here's decision time. Let me ask you, Danny. What do you do here if you're Sean Clark? Do you kick the field goal to go up 8 potentially if you make it, or do you go for the first down here and the knockout punch?
Well, on fourth downs, Appalachian State is 2 for 2. However, you hit the field goal, you get up by 8. So if Georgia Southern does score and get a 2-point conversion, that at best, you're tied. So the field goal would be the safest option. That's what they're going to do here.
Yeah, I agree with you. That's what I would do, too, and that's what Sean Clark has elected to do. This is a 37-yard kick, almost straight on, a little bit off to the left here for Statham. Kick is on its way, and it is an 8-point lead for App State with 2:44 to go. Can Georgia Southern rally and send this game to overtime? The final 2:44 on deck when we get back. A week from today, the Sun Belt Championship game in Conway, South Carolina, as the Louisiana Raging Cajuns take on the undefeated Coastal Carolina Chanticleers, 12 o'clock Eastern on ESPN. And Casey kicking off for the Mountaineers. And Hood will take a knee. So a crazy day in the Sun Belt, on and off the field. Crazy, and then there's been a lot of news. You got our rivalry game right here to wrap up the regular season in the conference. A great, spectacular finish to the conference regular season. Coastal Carolina has to come back in the final minute and beat Troy to stay unbeaten. And two new head coaches named. South Alabama goes with former defensive coordinator, 33-year-old Kane Womack, who comes back from Indiana to be their head coach. And Butch Jones, the former Tennessee head coach, named the new head coach this evening at Arkansas State, replacing Blake Anderson, who left for Utah State.
And spent this season as the assistant to Nick Saban at Alabama. A big pickup for Arkansas State.
Logan Wright gets just a couple of yards on the play and gets dropped by Nick Hampton, who's had himself a heck of a ball game. 8 tackles now for Hampton tonight.
And for Georgia Southern, you have no timeouts. This likely the final drive for the Eagles. They got to get a big play like they did before.
That's complete to Emil Smith up to the 39-yard line and a first down. So the Eagles run up from the line of scrimmage. Complete again, Malik Murray, his first catch of the ball game, the top receiver for the Eagles, and he gets out of bounds to stop the clock with 2:11.
Yeah, Mosley able to execute these short passes, and so far the Mountaineers haven't been able to stop the pass here in the last two drives. Have busted coverage, and Dexter Carter Jr. able to score.
Going down to the wire here in Statesboro, second down and 5. Going up top, and that ball is going to be intercepted at the 21-yard line, and that will do it. Nicholas Ross from Kell High School in Atlanta with the easy interception on a ball that had way too much air underneath it. And App State's going to end their 2-game losing streak to the Eagles here tonight.
And that's big. Big-time interception to secure the victory by Nicholas Ross, his first pick on the year. For App State, big redemption game for them, losing the last 2 years to Georgia Southern. Big comeback for Zach Thomas, who 2 years ago in Statesboro was knocked out in the first series and didn't play the rest of the game. Just years of what the Eagles were able to do, stalling tremendous progress that they've had in the past. So being able to come to Statesboro, final regular season game, able to get a win for your seniors is just big, and it is a big second half for them as well, fighting their way back.
Zach Thomas just slides, eating clock, and App State will finish the regular season 8-3, 6-2 in the Sun Belt, and so this will be the 7th consecutive season since they joined the conference, same year that Georgia Southern did in 2014, that they have finished 6-2 or better in the conference. Just absolutely an amazing record of success. First time in 4 years they're not going to be in play for the conference championship, but they'll finish with a win here tonight. And Georgia Southern will finish up the regular season at 7-5 and 4-4 in the conference.
Well, here's the thing. Georgia Southern able to play 12 games this season. Just being able to do that is such a tremendous accomplishment in its own right. App State as well, playing 11 games, only had one game they couldn't play. But just this is just big for the Sun Belt Conference as a whole. The fact that they were able to maneuver their way through postponements, cancellations, and for the Eagles to still play a 12-game season, a long season at that. And it's not over. Both of these teams are going to be putting bowl games here in the next week or so.
Oh, there you go.
And that just shows how deep in this rivalry goes. And at this point, it's just good to better just get on out of here.
And the App State players go to center field and start dancing on the Georgia Southern Eagles, and that's not going to be taken kindly. And the shoving continues here on the field. The coach is doing their best to try to separate things right now. And hopefully they can get things under control here and not let it get out of hand. It is a rivalry game, but let's keep it in perspective, guys. And let's head to the locker room. App State, a 34-26 winner here tonight.
Zach Thomas, two touchdown passes. Nate Noel had a big run that really opened things up for the Mountaineers. Overall, a solid victory, able to break a two-year losing streak for the Eagles.
And the Mountaineers outscored the Eagles 27-9 in the second half to erase a 10-point deficit. 34-26, the final. App State, the winner. And now for Danny Wan, our entire ESPN team. I'm Matt Stewart. Good night from Statesboro, and congratulations to App, who snaps a two-game losing streak to their rivals.